Hey everyone, thanks for joining me once again. Today we're here to talk about my preset for my demo on Juice by Steve Vai and how we created that tone on the Spark and using other tools that I have at my disposal. I'd like to talk about the guitar that I used, the amp model that I used on the Spark, the way I run it into my mixer, into Pro Tools, and then talk about how I do some post EQ. I haven't done that, didn't do that in the last video. Just a quick discussion about sort of filtering you can do on your signal. It's kind of a must, really, to get rid of some of that top end, that harsh, brittle sound that guitarists are known for producing. Anyway, if anyone knows Steve Vai, they should know about the album Alienlovesecrets. Steve had an enormous impact in my life. I got my first guitar 31 years ago, 1990 Christmas. And that same Christmas, my cousin brought Passion and Warfare around to our house for the family barbecue. Well, no one saw me all afternoon. It changed my life. Thanks, Steve. Never look back. And I could have gone for a whole multitude of Steve Vai songs to cover. And I will at some stage do some of the standards, For the Love of God, all that sort of stuff. But I really wanted to do something that is really upbeat, lots of fun to play, has lots of cool tricks in it. Something that I knew was going to be in the realms of Spark's capability. Okay, so without digressing too much, I've done a little bit of research. Forgive me if I look down a lot. I'm going to be just checking on my notes. Don't want to miss anything. So let's talk about Steve Vai's original tone on the album. We all know he's obviously designed the gem with Ibanez, and that's part of his integral tone and style of playing. He would have been using his white gem at that point in time, loaded with the Evos. But what's not really clear and is under a lot of debate is the amps that he used for that album. There's not a lot of first-hand information directly from Steve about it. So what I've been able to find out is that he has apparently stated that there would have been about four different cabs at any one time to get a really big sound. But apparently for Juice, someone is reported of said that he would have used an old Marshall 4x12 with room mics to give the guitar some body. But apparently he's going out of his modded JCM 800 Marshall head with a direct out to a Sans amp, which are pretty cool. Actually, I have a Sans amp Richard Kotzen fly rig, and they're really quite a cool little device. So he's going from the Sans amp into a speaker simulator. So apparently the very first non-programmable Sans amp, and the PSA-1 by Tech 21. Look, it's very possible that a Bogner Ecstasy was used on the album on a number of tracks, and there's a lot of online speculation about which ones, but there is no real confirmation. And whilst I tried the Bogner on the Spark, I wasn't able to get anywhere near the voicing I needed for Juice. So to my ears, it was a very modded Marshall tone, hence going for the BE 101, sorry, on the Spark, which is emulating the Friedman BE-100 amp. Another thing to note is various opinions online that Steve used a TS-9 tube screamer. to push his amps on that album. Again, unconfirmed. It's entirely possible, considering the results I got using my mid-gain exotic AC Plus boost overdrive pedal in front of the Spark. However, it's also possible that Steve used his go-to Boss DS1 pedal. We know that he's been using that for quite some time and is a big advocate of it. Okay, so here's a little bit about the Freedman. I didn't want to just to give a bit of an insight to the Freedman amp. The Freedman BE Brown Eye 100 reportedly a nod to EVH's brown sound and heavily inspired by a few Jose Arredondo mods, like the additional gain stage of the saturation switch that adds silicon clipping. Like the additional gain stage and also the saturation switch that adds silicon clipping after the cathode follower. And for anyone interested, Pete Thorne does a great video on Steve's actual JCM800 Jose modded Marshall and talks directly to the genius amp builder, Dave Friedman, who has personally gone over the amp himself. I'm personally a huge fan of Steve's earlier tone, probably due to the impact Passion Warfare had on me, and also the David Lee Roth ears and Whitesnake ears as well. Also, bizarrely enough, one of my favorite Steve Vai tones comes from the killer soundtrack from Bill and Ted's Bogus Journey. Not the usual suspect, not the Reaper, although a great song, but the Reaper rap. And at the end of the disc, it's so thick and juicy, and the solos are insane on that song. I love it. Do yourself a favor and check that one out too if you haven't already. Okay, let's have a quick chat about the guitar. So what I have here is you've probably seen it in the video already, is my 30th anniversary Gem 777 LNG. And no, everyone, they're not tea bags. They're the original tags from Ibanez. This is, I bought this guitar to be a look at guitar, so I could just have it there and look at it and appreciate it. It's never meant to be played, but I felt like Steve Vai demo deserved it. I want this guitar to stay in mint conditions. I'm prone to banging things from time to time. I don't want any chips or bumps in it. Okay, so a couple of little things about this one here. It's has the Evo 1s loaded on it, just like Steve would have had in the album. It's got a treble bleed on the pot. For anyone not knowing what that means, it just means that when you wind your volume down on your guitar, you're not losing any top end or attack, which is great. And one of the things that obviously I like to do when I do recordings, and I very rarely have the guitar on full. I mean, there are occasions where you might need it, and you might, it's good to have a little bit of room to go if you need a little bit of a solo boost as well. And I do actually do that on the demo video when it comes time to the midway solo, just to give it a little bit of a boost, I think all the way up. And also the tone, I tend to wind a little bit back as well, just to take away a bit of brittleness and to make the sound a little bit fatter, fuller. Because let's face it, the Evos are a pretty punchy, bright pickup. Great for Steve stuff, and great for a number of other things too, but they have a very particular voicing, and may not be to everyone's liking. But if you've never tried a Gem, go and pick one up. They're certainly a lot of fun. So the other thing to note on this one, on this particular demo, I've set this guitar up with 9 to 42s, the Ernie Ball Paradigms, actually, for durability. I usually like to use 10s to 52s, but they were just too taxing on this song. Steve is an animal. There's so much bending, so much whammy bar antics. And of course, the higher tension strings you have means you've got more spring tension. It just doesn't make using the bar as fun You know, so and the strings as well. I mean, whilst I would usually use 10s to 52s for durability, I have to say I still managed to break them. Not quite as much as I broke 9s, I think, in the 2 months that I was rehearsing Juice. I think I've gone through 3 packets of strings. It was ridiculous. I've never broken so many strings in my life. And I'm not talking about just the usual unwound ones. I was breaking A's and D's. I didn't break an E. it was mind-blowing. So much. It might be my fault. I'm not using a particularly heavy pick. Fortunately, I go from using different picks depending on who I'm trying to play. I didn't use my Jazz 3 pick when I did my Cliffs of Dover demo, as Eric Johnson likes to use. I just wasn't able to make it work. So having said that, on my John Petrucci I did use my Jazz 3. It has that, I was a more percussive sort of sound and that picking attack that I needed for that. Steve's, I've used one of these, which is the Jim Dunlop 1mm. I don't know if you can see that very well. There you go. The 1mm nylon pick. It's got a little bit of grip on it. I'm notorious for flicking picks out in the middle of solos as well. I like the grip on this one. They do wear out pretty quickly, especially when you're playing Steve, so you might need a packet of them sitting close by. And also, I do also use the thinner ones, the 85mm grey ones. At times, I know Steve is the 88mm, sorry. So I know Steve is reported to use fairly thin, floppy picks. For this one, I was finding that I was getting a bit more accuracy and a bit more consistency with the pinch and natural harmonics with the slightly firmer pick. As for the action on the guitar as well, I generally set my action really, really low. I'm a guitar tech, so I fret level all my own guitars and set everything up. The neck on the Gem is particularly straight. Only a very, very small amount of relief. The action is on this one with the 9s to 42s, 1.25mm on the nose, high E, low E, 12th fret. I usually set my action up at 1mm on the nose, on the high E, and just a smidgen over, more to John Petrucci's text settings on his action. They both have pros and cons. When you're playing Steve, a slightly higher action is more desirable. Particularly because of all the whammy bar antics, the last thing you want is the strings fretting out on the 24th fret when you're pulling up on the bar. If you have action sitting at 1mm and you're trying to do any crazy whammy bar antics, you'll probably run into problems there. And also for a slightly higher action is also going to allow the pinch harmonics and natural harmonics to be hit a little bit easier as well, with a little bit more clarity. Lower action, again, it's problematic when it comes to pinch harmonics and natural harmonics. So there's a number of reasons I changed the strings on only this guitar to 9 to 42. And having done that, I can understand why Steve predominantly uses 9 to 42 or 9s to 46s, and reportedly at times will go to a 10 to 46. I was playing this guitar so much my fingers were getting increasingly fatigued, and I'm glad I finished it when I did. I don't think I had another day left in me. So moving on, the fret wire on the Gem. I'm sorry I'm going into all this stuff, by the way. I just wanted people to get a little bit of insight into the tone coming out of the Spark is a combination of a lot of different factors. The guitar is very important. I tried doing the recording on other guitars with different pickups, different strings, different pickup heights, everything different, even different fret wire. Now the fret wire on the Gem is it's not your standard super jumbo that you might get on, say, for example, Ibanez Prestige RG or something like that. These are the Dunlop 6105s. They're tall, but narrow fret wire. Now, so there's benefits to that as well, and there's benefits to having the super jumbos as well. Some people really like that extra meat under their fingers. The narrower ones on the gem, however, they actually make the finger the fret positions feel a little bit more spacious and wide. I suppose particularly good for Steve because he's got monstrous hands, spider fingers. The narrower fret wire is particularly good for me in the sense that I've got fairly fat, stumpy hands, and I find particularly when up at the upper register of the guitar, having less fret wire is a bit more freeing, and I can actually fret the strings a little bit easier. Also, the scallop frets, the last four frets on the gems are scalloped, and really make grabbing those last four notes up there so much more pleasurable and easy. And we know that Steve loves to head up there and do some wailing. As far as me talking and you having to look at my ugly face any longer, we'll move on to the next part of our tutorial, which is the signal path and the settings I use on my OD pedal and the Spark app and the choices I've made there, and then on to the EQing. So bear with me. I'm sorry if I'm waffling or mumbling. I do that too. So from our guitar, we go into our overdrive pedal. For my Juice demo, I used the B side of the Exotic AC Plus for a bit more tonal control. I'll explain that in a second. With your usual standard knobs, we've got volume, gain, we've got a bass, middle, treble. We've got a hard clipping and a soft clipping button. I found I had a bit more clarity with the soft clipping with this one here. Not quite as distorted. Let's have a look at the settings. So first of all, let's have a look at the guitar straight into the, without any effects, without anything engaged on the Spark amp, with all the EQs on the mixer flat. So basically, as if your guitar is going straight into the input of your door. Let's have a listen. This is the bridge pickup of the gem. We've got, so it sounds pretty weak, just like that. No preamp, no nothing. Let's give everyone an idea of, just quickly I'll give everyone an idea of what the neck pickup sounds like. Obviously a little bit bassier and, you know, neck-like, for want of a better word. Okay, so the boost pedal I've set up in this particular way, and it will make more sense when I actually add the gain on the BE amp on the Spark. For now, this is the sort of tone you want to be looking for from your OD pedal first up, with just a clean, dry, no preamp signal at all. We're going to stick our volume on around about 1030. The gain on full, remember this is only a medium to light gain pedal. It's not going to break up the signal a whole lot. Now for this, for our EQ on this particular pedal, the bass is set at 100 hertz. The low E is generally around about 80 hertz, I believe. So it's getting most of the low end of the guitar. We're just going to use that to help push the signal into the Spark a bit. We're going to put the mid, which is set at 1.2 Ks, on the Exotic, this particular Exotic pedal. We're going to set that to about 3 o'clock. We want to push that mid frequency into the Spark a bit more. The treble, however, on this instance, we're going to have almost all the way off, probably around about 7 o'clock. It's almost off. And that's that on the Spark is 10 kilohertz. That's what it said on the exotic pedal, sorry. And again, the soft clipping is on the pedal at the moment. No hard clipping, soft clipping. So let's give it an idea. Again, guitar. And with the pedal. So one good thing about the exotic pedal, it's quite transparent. It's what they're known for. I know people hate using that word, but it is. You can still hear an element of the guitar, raw tone going through, and it's mixing a certain amount of that signal, the overdriven signal, through it as well. All right, so I'm going to just switch that off for a minute, and we're going to have a look at the... All right, and let's have a look at our Spark amp. Spark app, sorry. Let's first of all start with our the BE, the amp this time. We'll build our tone slightly differently than when we did the other ones. So hopefully I'll give you everyone a demo every time I tweak something. Okay, let's engage the amp and see what we get. So already we've got like no volume. So I'm just gonna, for the purposes of this, I'm gonna stick the volume on about 6.4 because I know that when I engage the other settings on it, we will get some more signal. Okay, still nothing there yet. Let's engage the gain. And for this, we're gonna go to about... we go to about 5.7. Sorry, I have to use my, I'm using my phone, not a tablet to do this, so it makes it a bit touchy. So far we've got, again, not a hell of a lot of volume or push there, but when I start to EQ on the mixer, it'll start making more sense. And okay, the bass, we're gonna have a look at that. On this one here, we're gonna go up to about 6.8, doesn't have to go up, 6.7. You can hear that boominess coming through right now. All right, let's engage the middle. We're gonna go full. Let's have a listen now. Oh, now we start to get there. Now, treble, we wanted this to be nice. We want to introduce as much of the guitar's frequency, I believe, into the door, because there we can do some more shaping of the tone and EQing to get rid of any unwanted or harsh frequencies. Okay, with the treble, we got... whoa, that's pretty gritty, but tough. Still not quite the volume that we're looking for just yet. Now, so with just that, and now I'll engage the... I dropped my phone. I'll engage the overdrive pedal. So again, without, we've got... and with the overdrive pedal, again, it doesn't add a lot of gain to it. A little bit of color. I'll try that again. Off. On. Off, on. All right, so yeah, I mean, obviously it's a little bit more boomy here, but we can deal with that later. All right, next in line, we're gonna have a look at engaging the boost pedal. Let's turn it on, and we're gonna wind this, run this all the way up. Okay, all the way up to 10. So now we've got, again, we haven't really lost, I mean, we've introduced a little bit of noise. This is with my overdrive pedal off and the boost off, overdrive pedal on and the boost back on. All right, we're getting some noise, but it's not really coloring the signal at this point, which is good. Now let's go into our sustainer pedal. We're going to go level 5.8, so I know where I want it. Just to be past unity. There, 5.7 should be fine. We're going to go to our tone, which is just under halfway, 4.3 is fine. Attack, we're going to go about half. And the sustain, we're going to go for, this is where you might want to fiddle around to your own preferences. You might find that it's introducing too much noise. You might have hotter pickups than me. You might have weaker pickups than me. Let's go for about 5.2. Right, so we've got so far. All right, let me turn it off quickly. Back on. All right, a little bit of noise there. Now we can deal with that noise by introducing our noise gate. And again, we're just going to wind it up till we're comfortable that... Yep, my OD pedal's still on. There's still a little bit of a trail there, so I'm just gonna give it maybe make it up to one. That's better. Okay, might even want it higher if you want it to cut out quicker. All right, now let's move on to flanger. Now, one thing to note is that generally with flangers, I like to stick them before the amp. There are a lot of professional guitarists that like to do that. A flanger after the amp can take over a little bit too much and can sort of consume the tone a bit. Beforehand, it's a bit more subtle and it really just enhances, gives some body. But we don't have that in the Spark. We don't have that luxury, that option. So we're just going to deal with what we've got. Well, you know, work with what we've got. Let's start introducing some knobs. Sorry, we're gonna leave the rate down all the way off. We don't want any sweeping going on with our flanger. We're gonna stick the mix on all the way, and I'll actually sweep through the mix and I'll tell you why I've gone that extreme. And the rate, we're gonna stick on around about half, about five. Now I'll give you a demonstration as to the difference that makes. So you can still hear that there's a sweep going on there. It's not so noticeable when you're running it in context of alongside the backing track, and you've got your delay and your reverb to come yet. So let's just have a look at the mix knob there and have a demonstration as like. Obviously the mix is all the way off. We've still got our depth up. I'll turn it off. Back on. I'll put the mix up to about half. Now all the way. To my ears, having the mix all the way up, although not ideal, it actually makes the guitar sound a bit wider. I'm wearing headphones at the moment. And if we look at the sweep, the reason why I've gone there is too low and you end up getting this sort of unpleasant sort of sound. You want the frequency to be sitting on something a bit fatter. Again, it doesn't sound great in context with just the guitar on its own. It'll make more sense in a minute. All right, so now we're gonna have a look at our echo tape. I've gone for this one because it enables me to control the actual tone and actually filter out some of the high end on it. So let's have a look. We've got about 0.8 on repeats. We really don't want too many repeats going on there. So far we've got... All right, you can't hear anything there because I've got no volume. Now we've got volume. We're gonna go... Volume one, we don't need a huge amount of volume on this one. Just want a little bit of a trail. The tone, I'm gonna set to around about 5.3. Just roll off some of that high end. And let's see, and the timing is 500 milliseconds. That's what I like to put it on for this particular track. So let's have a listen now. We've got... All right, so we've got about three or four sort of trails there. You could set it even lower. If I do that, it'll sound like this. Cool. I might as well leave it there. That's not a problem. Now, if I were to introduce a tone all the way up, you'll see what happens here. It becomes more pronounced. Because there's no damping feature on the...
Drop my phone again.
There's no damping feature on the echo tape. The delay is always going to be there. So having that tone function is the next best thing. It doesn't drown out the actual note that you're playing while the delay is actually occurring. As far as the volume is concerned, let's mess around with that. So I've got, if I go all volume. Oh, no, we don't want that. Even half is too much. Too much. So we'll go back to where we were. All right, now we're going to go for the all-important reverb. And like I said, I'm not judging anyone for how much or how little they like to use of a particular effect. I do it because, you know, I think the original recording has some elements of it in there, and I'm working with the tools that I've got. Again, with this one here, we're going to go with a short plate. And once again, I'm going to stick my level all the way up. The level is not all the way up. The level is meant to be at 8.6, my bad. So just about all the way up. Dampening is going to be off. The low cut, we want to lose a little bit of that low end. We're going to go 5.6 on the low cut. And again, we're just going to take a little bit of top end off, just the reverb, 1.1 on the high cut. The time is set at 2.8 on this one, and the dwell is actually going to be all the way off on this one. We don't want to wash out the sound too much. Let's have a listen. Again, sounds nice and wide without being too washed out. Let's try that again. All right, we're getting within the realms of where we want to be. Okay, so at this point, we can now move on to the way that I like to set the EQ on the mixer. Sorry, my head's away from the microphone. Okay, so we're going to start by obviously engaging the low cut switch is already engaged. Sorry, I forgot to mention that. So it's already, the low cut is already, the switch is already taking off some frequencies below 75 hertz, just to get rid of some of that boominess. All right, we're gonna go straight for our treble, and we're gonna just notch it back to about minus 2 dB on the treble, which is the 12 kilohertz one, and we're gonna go fairly extreme on the 2.5. We're gonna set that to around about 10. Actually, before I do that, let's have a look at what winding the treble back a little bit did. Just took away a little bit of that bitiness. I'll put it back. I know that does sound pretty cool, but when you listen to Steve's original track, it's a lot smoother than that, and there's no doubt some top end being taken off. Now we're going to pop the middle. The middle has been popped up to 10, and now we've got this, and we're going to get a bit of a significant volume boost now. Whoa, that's a massive volume jump. Let's try that again. That's where we're at the moment. I know it's still not perfect, not ideal. In fact, I might even just wind that back just a tad and just treble back a little bit. So So this is our bass tone now. We've got... that's without any processing in Pro Tools at this point in time. Okay, so we can move on to the Pro Tools, and we can actually look at engaging our EQ on the guitar track. Now, let's see if I can do this in real time. Let's see if it'll let me. All right. Let me do it in real time with the guitar. But what I can do is I can just quickly switch this off and show you guys what it sounds like and what the settings are. Okay, so I've just worked out how I can do this in real time. I've got my four band equalizer on the screen at the moment. You can have a look at the way I've got it set up. Currently, when I'm talking to you, it's in bypass mode. So let's have a quick listen to what the guitar sounds like without the mixer again, the EQ. And let's switch the bypass off and engage it. And I've had to wind you can see that I've had to wind the input down by about 4 dBs to keep it around about, to keep it from clipping. And you'll notice a big boost in low end and low mids. Huge, beefy, kick-ass sound. Only a small roll-off at the top end there again. A bit of quite a significant boost in the 1.6 kilohertz range, and a little bit of a boost in the 280 hertz. Again, it's all to your taste. It all depends on the pickups that you've got. This is the way I liked it, and it worked well when I put it up alongside the backing track. I hope everyone found this one informative and helpful. If you've got any questions, comments, or feedback, feel free to chime in. Let me know. And again, if you have any, if you do a video or record yourself using my method and system, or my tone, my preset, feel free to send me a link and I'll have a listen. Now, the all important thing, this tone on Tone Cloud will be named, wait for it, Vai Juice at All. This is Vai Juice at All, spelled V. Why am I guessing that? V-A-I. Okay, so Vai Juice at All. I will put some hashtags in there because I know how notoriously hard it can be to find specific presets on the Tone Cloud. So try looking specifically for the hashtag alienlovesecrets, all one word, obviously. I'll pop on there as well the hashtag juice. I'll pop on there the hashtag Steve Vai. But no doubt there's going to be a bunch that comes up. Now, please, if you decide to take my preset and pop it back on the cloud, please rename it something unique other than my name that I've chosen, because it throws people off when they're actually searching for mine. And it's happened a lot. And it happens a lot. So please, rename it. It's no longer my setting once you've done things to it. So I'm more than happy for you to copy it. But just rename it, please. Anyway, all right. For now, thanks for listening. Thanks for watching. And stay tuned for the next demo, which will be an epic YJM demonstration of too many notes. Ciao for now. I knew that I wouldn't. I feel good. I knew that I wouldn't.